Hello friends of human spaceflight, and welcome to another week in review as we look into the space industry and notable launch activities from around the world. Coming up, just who will crew the Artemis 2 mission around the moon and back? NASA revealed the Fantastic Four, paving the way for humanity's return over half a century later. India tested a neat little reusable craft known as Lex, and wow, what a landing that was. We go from Lex to Flex as we take a look at Astrolab's Lunar Rover and their future mission to the moon with SpaceX. But there's a crypto rover headed there soon. What's that now? Moscow, we have a lawsuit. Russia's Baikonur Cosmodrome has been seized. What's all this about? There's plenty more to come, so please stick around for another huge week in review. Let's go! Shortly after our last episode went live, NASA announced who will crew the Artemis 2 mission around the moon and back. It's a massive deal, over half a century in the making. Not since the end of the Apollo program in 1972 have we seen humanity in close proximity to the moon. Before a captive audience at Ellington Field, near NASA's Johnson Space Center in Houston, the big reveal was moments away once they navigated the usual runs of speeches from leadership. And with that, the first crew member was revealed to be mission specialist Christina Koch, a NASA astronaut since 2013. Holds the record for the longest single spaceflight by a woman with 328 days in space. She served as flight engineer on the International Space Station for expeditions 59, 60, and 61, and participated in the first all-female spacewalk. Koch, a native of Michigan, has a background in electrical engineering and physics and has contributed to numerous space science missions. She has conducted 6 spacewalks and also serves in leadership roles with the Astronaut Office and NASA Johnson Space Center. Lucky astronaut number 2, and also a mission specialist, is Jeremy Hansen, born in London, Ontario. He is set to make history as the first Canadian to venture to the moon, and this will also be his first spaceflight. With a Bachelor of Science in Space Science and a Master of Science in Physics, he served as a CF-18 freighter pilot and combat operations officer. Now, Hansen's assignment to the Artemis 2 mission marks a new milestone in his career. As an experienced fighter pilot and leader, Hansen's expertise and contributions are highly valued. His achievements continue to inspire young Canadians and individuals around the world as he sets his sights on this historic mission to the moon. Hansen's dedication to science and his passion for aviation makes him a worthy representative of Canada in the field of space exploration, and his journey to the moon is eagerly anticipated by space enthusiasts and Canadians alike. Just ask Ryan Reynolds. Crew member number 3 is no stranger to space enthusiasts. Victor J. Glover Jr., a California native, has had an impressive career as an astronaut and military aviator. Selected as an astronaut in 2013, his accomplishments include serving as a pilot and second in command on the Crew 1 SpaceX Crew Dragon, named Resilience, which completed a long-duration mission aboard the International Space Station from November 2020 to May 2021. This mission was the first post-certificate flight of SpaceX Crew Dragon spacecraft and marked his second crewed flight on that vehicle. Glover also served as a flight engineer on the International Space Station for Expedition 64, where he conducted scientific investigations and technology demonstrations. Prior to his astronaut career, Glover had a distinguished military background as a naval aviator and test pilot. Glover holds multiple degrees, and his educational achievements, along with his diverse experience in military and space exploration, have made him a highly skilled and accomplished astronaut. His dedication to his work, his commitment to advancing space exploration, and his numerous accomplishments make him an inspiration to aspiring astronauts, and an asset to NASA's Artemis 2 mission, where he has been assigned as pilot. And last but certainly not least, the Artemis 2 commander is Reed Wiseman, who hails from Baltimore, Maryland. He has served as flight engineer aboard the International Space Station for Expedition 41 from May through November of 2014, marking his first spaceflight. During the 165-day mission, Reed and his fellow crewmates conducted over 300 scientific experiments, contributing to our understanding of space and its effects on the human body. Notably, they achieved a milestone for station science by completing a record-breaking 82 hours of research in a single week in July 2014, showcasing Reed's dedication to advancing scientific knowledge in space. Prior to joining NASA, Reed had a distinguished career in the military as a naval aviator, flying F-14 Tomcat and F-A-18F Super Hornet aircraft, and supporting various operations around the world. Reed's achievements in space exploration, combined with his dedication to scientific research, social media outreach, and leadership, make him a true inspiration to aspiring astronauts and space enthusiasts alike. So, launching around November 2024, the Artemis II crew and the Orion capsule will orbit high above Earth initially, while tests are conducted on various new systems and procedures. Orion will separate from the ICPS before seeing the crew test the spacecraft's cameras, thrusters, and maneuverability by lining up with the discarded second stage booster. Once all looks good to go, the translunar injection burn will see Artemis II and its crew flung deeper into space and on their way for a single lap around the moon. A path some 10,300 kilometers past the far side of the moon before a 4-day trip back home. Of course, landing on the moon is not part of the mission plan as hardware is still being developed. From spacesuits to Starship and Gateway, there's still plenty to be done. So why no orbit of the moon at least? NASA decided on this crude shakedown flight path for safety reasons as they check out life support, flight controls, space radiation measurements, and communications, among other systems. All data gathered during the mission will pave the way for Artemis III, which will land astronauts near the lunar South Pole sometime in 2025 at this stage. So, with the International Space Station currently home to Russian, American, and Emirati astronauts, the first crew to return to the moon will be American and Canadian astronauts. Europe will have their service module going for the ride, so yeah, at least they've got that going for them. Further developments on the recent sad news of Virgin Orbit ceasing operations and terminating most of its employees after failing to secure further financial backing. Now it's official. Shortly after, Virgin Orbit Holdings filed for Chapter 11 bankruptcy protection in the United States. A move to assist with a maximum value sale of assets for the failed business venture. Now that the staff have been let go, it's all about salvaging as much as they can, with the company reported to have listed assets somewhere around $243 million, and a debt around $153 million. But those figures are likely to have changed over time until now. Sir Richard Branson's Virgin Group owns around 75% of Virgin Orbit, having invested heavily to the tune of some $1 billion. Branson already stumped up $70 million over recent months. Jim Cantrell, chief executive of Phantom Space, estimated the Virgin Orbit would have needed to make as many as 100 launches a year in order to break even. It seems in the current financial climate of the space sector, there isn't unwillingness to invest in expensive technologies, such as reliance on carbon fiber. With other companies providing considerably cheaper launch costs, it's hard to see who would want to invest now. Despite this, of the workforce that was dismissed, some 100 remain to keep the company ticking over while they look for a buyer with deep pockets. Israel conducted a recent drop test of a proposed reusable launch vehicle known as RLV Lex. In the early dawn of April 2nd, an Indian Air Force Chinook helicopter took off with Lex suspended beneath. At some 14,763 feet, Israel claimed a new world first record as they had just passed the altitude of Sierra Nevada's Dream Chaser test, which dropped in a similar fashion back in 2017, from just over 12,000 feet. An automated sequence took over, monitoring the 10 parameters essential for a safe drop test. Once conditions were optimal, it was timed with the test vehicle already over 4 kilometers downrange from the runway. Autonomous navigation, guidance, and control systems were essential here, as Lex is a low lift to drag ratio craft, simulating a re-entry very steep glide slope. Explains this thumping landing here at around 350 kilometers per hour. Now from Lex, we head over to Flex. I thought I'd take a peek at what other rovers are planned for the lunar surface. We recently spoke of UAE Rashid Rover, hopefully deployed later this month on the Hakuto R lander. Still some years away is Astrolab's Flexible Logistics and Exploration, or FLEX rover. No longer a concept, a full-size prototype has been undergoing testing in the California desert since 2022. With a mass of over 2 ton, Starship will be needed for this space buggy, and a recent agreement has been reached with SpaceX to deliver. It will be the biggest and, of course, most technologically advanced rover to roam the lunar regolith. The rover is not just an unpressurized transportation system. Described as a logistics platform by its creators, FLEX will be adaptable and meet mission demands for the Moon and Mars. Unlike historic rover designs, catering for a single mission purpose, FLEX will use a modular design, fulfilling multiple purposes for conducting science, establishing infrastructure, and deploying other technologies to the lunar surface. A quick disclaimer here, the following is not a paid advertisement, in fact, nothing here is, but if you want to sponsor, let us know. Now here's a unique rover concept. Lunar Outpost's Mobile Autonomous Prospecting Platform, or MAP, is scheduled to launch late this year atop a SpaceX Falcon 9 rocket. The rover will touch down near the Moon's south pole aboard Intuitive Machines' Nova C lander and be able to autonomously prospect the lunar surface for resource-rich areas. Certainly there for some serious science. Here's the twist. It also hosts to a Willy Wonka-style golden ticket race to the Moon.
Any good?
On board is a metal plate with the private key needed to unlock a crypto wallet containing 62 bitcoins, currently valued at $1.5 million. One individual, or a group, prepared to split the bounty can devise a way to get there, locate the rover, and its key. It's all promoted as a way to inspire and encourage innovation and space exploration. The link is below if you want to see what it's all about. Who will be the lucky Charlies to unlock the bounty? Just don't lose suit pressure out there, you could join Pro Violet here. According to a Moscow Times report on the 14th of March 2023, Kazakhstan had seized property belonging to Roscosmos, the Russian space agency. The article claims that the decision was made due to the Russian state company's debt of 13.5 billion tenge, or $29.7 million, to the Baytarek Kazakh-Russian joint venture for the work related to estimating ecological damages caused by Soyuz 5 rockets. Just days before the seizure, the head of Roscosmos, Yuri Borisov, had made unsavory remarks regarding Minister Bagdat Musin's team's decision to postpone the building of new spacecrafts at the Cosmodrome. Originally built for the testing of the R-7 ICBM for the Soviet Union in the 1950s, Baikonur has become critical for human spaceflight, and not only provides cosmonauts a ride to the ISS, but also astronauts too. But what will this mean for Russia and its access to space? Thankfully, Russia have another launch site, right?
Right?
Construction of the Vostochny Cosmodrome started in 2012 in the Amur region near the Chinese border. However, due to large-scale embezzlement and fraud surrounding the project, it is as of yet not finished, with many at the top of this project being charged in recent years. What does this mean for Russian access to space? As always, let us know your thoughts below. Well, that's it for now. Time to come up for some air. What a great week that was, with plenty happening. We look forward to bringing you the latest developments in space news next week, and some fun along the way. Thanks for watching, and remember, onwards to the future. There's your bloopers. The article claims that the decision... It just went straight back to the top of the script. Well, that's not helpful. Here we go. Right.